copyrighted program created by Rio Grande.
Clark County, Wyoming Sheriff's Office calling all cars. Attention all cars. Broadcast 278 regarding an escaped prisoner. Be on the lookout for Earl Duran, 6 feet 2 inches, weight 170 pounds. This man escaped from the Cody, Wyoming jail March the 16th. He is armed and dangerous. That's all. Rose and Quiz.
Not all highway robbery is committed at the point of a gun. Some of it is perpetrated by the unseen bandits of Grip and Dust, who take command of defenseless bulk oils and bore from within to undermine the efficiency of your motor, shatter its morale, and ultimately send it to the condemned road. For that reason, tens of thousands of Western motors are entrusting the lives of their motors to Rio-Lube, the great lubricant that wears the impenetrable armor of sealed, tamper-proof cans, making Rio-Lube the perfect bodyguard of every vital moving part. This pure 100% paraffin-based motor oil is so completely de-waxed and de-jellied that the most severe cold weather cannot change its quick, smooth flow to every part of your motor. If 1,000 miles have rolled by since your last oil change, do this. When you turn into the nearest Rio Grande station in the morning for that tank full of cracked gasoline, have the crankcase drained and take aboard some Rio-Lube or Rio Grande, Pennsylvania. There are no finer motor oils sold in the West. The story we are to hear tonight has been taken from the confidential files of the sheriff of Park County, Wyoming. Its solution was made possible by the cooperation of the law enforcement agencies of the region in which it occurred, and as another example of the cooperation of such agencies, Sheriff Eugene Biscoviz of Los Angeles County has asked Under-Sheriff A.C. Jewell to open our program.
The theme of calling all cars has been for 6 years the fact that crime does not pay. And like other programs dealing with the criminal element, there never has been a glorification of criminals. Rather, a glorification of the work a peace officer does in proving to the criminal element the losing nature of crime. Our office has been asked many times if our opinion calling all cars contribute to the public good. We can truthfully say this program does a great deal of good. We, the law enforcement officers who appear in these programs, know that through this program over the years, a new understanding and appreciation of your law enforcement officer has resulted. We feel also the one thing young and old alike have learned from calling all cars is that crime is definitely losing proposition.
In the city of Powell, Wyoming, a group of young boys are gathered about a tall youth holding a gun.
Gee, Earl, that's a swell rifle. Let me see it.
Don't fool with it, Bill. Load it.
Guy, Savage 22, high power. Boy, I bet you could kill an elk with that one.
I've done it.
Killed an elk?
Sure, lots of them.
When?
Last winter.
All right, boys. Earl, you take number 2 target. Bill, you take number 3.
Okay.
Fire at will. Range 50 yards.
50? Too close, Mr. Smith. Can I use the 200-yard target?
No, the 50's hard enough. You'll do well to hit it.
Yeah? Just watch me.
Oh, boy, look at that. 5 shots and 5 bullseyes.
Nuts. I could do that with a bow and arrow.
Well, maybe you had better take the other target.
Yes, sir. That won't make any difference.
Bullseyes
again.
Gee, Mr. Smith, he's a guy that can't miss.
Mr. Smith, mind if I go over to the archery target? This is no fun. I never miss what I'm shooting at.
Then one day, as the snow whipped about the home of the Durans near Powell, Earl Duran lay on a pain-racked bed.
Will my boy get well, Doctor?
Yeah, I can't tell yet, Mrs. Duran.
He's got to, Doctor. He's all we have in the world. He's our only son.
How did he get shot like this?
You tell him, will you?
Well, you see, Doctor, Earl had been out hunting. He had just come in. He was sitting there by the fire, getting ready to clean his gun. Ma and I were just finishing supper. Any luck today, Early?
Sure, Dad. A couple of bobcats. Didn't seem much to shoot at, though.
don't see how you could see anything in this blizzard.
I don't have to see him very well to shoot him.
Aren't you hungry, son?
No, Mother, thanks. I had a steak.
Where'd you get a steak?
Where'd you cook it?
I didn't cook it. I ate it just as it was.
Raw?
Sure, I wanted to try it once. Some of the fellas down at school were talking about it. They said it was good, so I thought I'd try it.
Bet you didn't like it, did you?
Oh, not much. Wasn't so bad, though, after you got used to it.
Well, you'd better not tell anybody about it. They'll think you're a wild man, but with your hair so long and that beard.
You'd better be careful taking that rifle apart. It might be loaded.
No, no, I unloaded it. I don't care what they call me, Ma. Some of the fellows already call me Tarzan of the Tea Garden.
Why, that's silly.
Oh, I don't know. I do love to live outdoors as much as I can. The air is cold and crisp. I love to have the snow blowing in my face. To hear the wind howling up there among the mountains. Listen to it howling outside.
You better watch what you're doing instead of gazing at the rafters while you're loading that gun.
Well, that's that till tomorrow. I'll just leave it here on the mantel.
Oh, oh my God. Mother, there. Oh, he dropped the gun.
Put him in bed, then we call you.
I'm so afraid he's going to die, Doctor.
Father, he's come too.
Yes, son. I'm coming.
Mother, now take it easy, Earl. You'll be all right.
Will I, Doc?
Why, sure you will. Just get lots of rest. Stay out in the open all you can when you get up and around. You'll be all right.
Thank you, Doctor.
I'll be out every day for a while to take a look at him. That bullet punctured a lung. May have to fight tuberculosis for a while.
We'll take good care of him.
As soon as he's able to get about, let him sleep outside as much as he can. Don't keep him cooped up. Well, I'll run along. See you tomorrow, son.
Months roll by. Gradually, Earl Durand recovers, but his point of view toward life has changed with the passing days. The faraway hills, the streams, call to him more strongly than ever.
Early, it's about time you got back to school, don't you think?
I'm not going back to school, Dad.
Boy, that's nonsense. Well, you've only finished the first year in high school.
I'm not going back.
But, son, I want you to have a good education. I want you to have every chance you can.
Dad, I couldn't stand to be cooped up in the schoolroom again.
Well, what are you going to do?
Well, I don't know. Work around some of the ranches, I guess. Hunt a little. I can keep them starving.
But you'll never amount to anything that way.
So what? What difference does it make? What's the use of struggling to make a lot of money, raise a family? What does it get you?
Well, it's mighty comforting to know you're a good citizen.
Oh, nuts. I don't care anything about being a good citizen. I don't bother anybody. I don't want to be around a lot of people. I just don't like crowds. I'd rather be off in the mountains by myself.
Well, Early, you know your own mind, I guess. When you decide to settle down, there'll always be a place for you here.
Oh, gee, Dad. You talk like I was going to run away or something. I'll be in every week or so to get some fresh clothes and some salt and stuff.
Where are you going now, son?
Well, Gus and his kid and Tom and I are going up above Wapiti to see if we can get an elk or two.
But don't you know you're not supposed to shoot elk up there?
Sure, but Gus has got to have some meat to last until spring, and it's the only way to get it. Besides, it'll be a lot of fun.
Sometimes you worry me, son.
Ah, cheer up, Dad. I'll be all right. See you Sunday.
On Sunday, March 12th, Earl and his companion shot four elk on the Shoshone Reservation and left them there, planning to return next day and haul the meat home. Game wardens discovered the slaughtered elk and placed a stakeout at the scene to capture the poachers. Through the long, icy day, Deputy Wardens Dwight King and Boyd Benyon waited for the men to return.
See him, Benyon?
No, not a sign.
They'll be along before dark. I'll bet a buck on it.
You know, it wouldn't be so bad if this wind had let up a little.
Wait a minute. Thought I heard a car coming.
Huh? Oh, you're right. There's a car coming up the trail.
See it yet?
Yeah, there it is. Stopping over there where the elk carcass is at.
They're going to load them on.
Well, let's take it.
Okay.
Stay right where you are. We're game, Martin.
So what? See the stuff?
Oh, no, you don't.
Get on the running board, Benny.
I got it. Oh, all right, you birds. Get them up.
Just to you, Warden. I'm leaving you at this point. Try and catch me.
Hey, get that guy, King. He's running away.
Hey, stop. Stop
or I'll shoot! Now let him go, King. We'll take these fellas in and get him later.
Okay, get this can started and let's get into town.
Well, they got away. Couldn't see very well. Missed him every time, I think.
Well, never mind. We'll get him in the morning. I know where he was. That Durand boy, Earl.
Earl trial of the captured poachers was deferred until the time the escaped man would be captured. On March 14th, Deputy Wardens Leonard Morris, King, Kenyon, and Tex Kennedy trailed Duran to a cul-de-sac in Shoshone Canyon. Separating, King and Kenyon advanced in a flanking move to surprise the fugitive.
See him over there by that rock, King?
Yep. That's Durand, all right. He's the one who got away from us Monday night.
I'm going to yell at him.
Go ahead.
Come out of there, Durand. We've got you covered.
Yes, he's shooting.
You're telling me. He's going to put one into the rocks right by his head.
Now, that's the warning, Durand. Come on with your hands in the air.
Standing up.
Drop that rifle.
Don't get so excited, Benyon. I'm not going to shoot you.
Yeah? Well, what do you call that shot you just took at me?
Listen, Benyon, I was just fooling with you. Anytime I get ready to shoot you, you'll be shot. I don't miss.
So I've heard. Get the cuffs on him, King.
Okay.
Never mind. I'm not going to try to get away. Let's go.
You're not going to be so willing to go along if you don't stop shooting at people.
Hey, King, bring Durand over here.
What's up?
I think you got this fake beef, Durand.
What do you think?
I think you killed that beef just a little while ago. Still warm.
So what?
Killing somebody else's cattle is a felony, young man. That's going to be a tough rap.
Sentence of the court, therefore, that you, Gus, should be confined in the county jail for a period of 60 days, and that you pay to the clerk of the court a fine of $100.
George, Your Honor.
I'm going to put you two younger boys on probation for a period of 6 months. You, Earl Durand, I hereby sentence to a term of 6 months in the county jail and a fine of $100.
6 months?
Yes, young man, 6 months.
Why?
Didn't you admit you did the shooting that killed the elk?
Well, yes, but...
And didn't you admit that the other men with you were merely in illegal possession of the meat?
But 6 months, Judge, I can't stand being in jail for 6 months.
In addition to that, young man, you'll be tried on the charge of beef killing. And I might remind you that is a felony. You'll receive a much longer sentence for that offense.
Longer sentence? Longer than 6 months? Why... You can't do this to me. I won't stay in jail. You can't keep me in jail. You can't!
For the love of Mike, Durant, you have to keep pacing up and down like that? You think this here guy's never been inside a jail before?
Shut up, all of you. You're just a pack of coyotes yapping, always yapping.
Ah, forget it. 6 months ain't long. You'll get used to it.
6 months. Long time. 6 months.
Let me out of here. I got to get out of here. Right down, you lad. You'll have Riley in here on your neck.
Right. That's it, Riley. He'll be here to feed us in a little while.
That's it, Riley. Here comes the grub fellas.
I'm going to get in or I'll throw it out.
Hey, where's Durand? What's wrong with you guys?
Here I am, Mr. Riley. He hit Riley with a damn milk bottle. Get back there, all of you. I'll plug the first guy to make the move. Think I'm going to sit here and rot in this hole? You're not. This gun of Mr. Riley is going to come right in handy. Come on, Riley. On your feet. We're leaving now.
Oh, take it easy, young fella. You just about fractured my skull, that milk bottle.
Come on, get going.
Rush, mate. Okay. But don't get nervous with that gun.
Close the door.
Where to, Durand?
To the sheriff's office. A nice 30-30 automatic rifle in there.
You won't get away with it, Durand.
Maybe not. But at least I'll die in the open, not in that filthy cell.
Okay, Earl. There's a gun vault.
Here's the rifle I need. And a pocket full of little sandy cartridges.
What?
Now we're on our way.
You're not going to take me with you, are you?
You guessed it, my friend. Lucky thing for Sheriff Blackburn. He's been out in California. I'd have to take him along, too.
He's really going to be on your trail for this. Why don't you get this crazy idea out of your head, Durand?
Maybe that's why. Maybe I am crazy. Anyway, I'm going to the mountains where I'll have room to breathe. Come on, get in the car.
Well, why don't you leave me here? Just take the car.
Unless you organize a posse? Don't make me laugh. Besides, I don't drive so well. Get going.
Where to, Durand?
My dad's place. 3 miles east of Powell, and keep off the main road.
Durand's precaution had come too late. Merle Prue of Cody, passing by, had seen Riley come out of the jail, hands in the air. As rapidly as he was able, he pursued the fleeing prisoner and his hostage. But Durand discovered the car behind him.
Hey, there's a car following us. Slow down.
Take it easy now, Earl.
Go on, Nosey. Beat it.
Abandoning the chase in the face of Durand's fire, Prue returned to Cody and spread the alarm. Wyoming's greatest manhunt was on. County Attorney Oliver Stephen took charge.
Get a wire out to Sheriff Blackburn. Tell him to fly back here immediately.
Yes, sir.
Get those prisoners back in jail. Lock them up.
Yes, sir.
Notify Chief of Police Lewis and Powell to watch for Durand.
Yes, sir.
Blockade all roads leading to the mountain. He's headed that way.
Yes, sir.
Get moving, all of you. Bring Earl Durand back here.
Meantime, Durand forced Riley to drive him by a circuitous route toward his home, your power.
Okay, Riley. The end of the line, all out.
Oh,
quiet. Yes, you'll get over it. Come on in the house. Maybe Ma will give you an aspirin.
Hey, you don't mean to say you're going to stay here? Well, this will be the first place they'll look for you.
Oh, no, they won't. I think I've headed for the mountain. Inside.
Okay.
Ma! Dad! I'm home again.
Mr. Riley, what are you doing here?
He's been kidnapped, Moss. I brought him along when I broke jail.
Oh, Early, how'd you...
What's that gun for, son?
He broke out of jail, Mr. Durand. I tried to get him not to come here.
I had to have some things. Do I get him without an argument, Dad, or do I have to take him?
This is your home, son. You're privileged to do whatever you want to in it.
Oh, Earl, I hardly know you. You look so strange. Not tall like my Earl.
Forget it. Dad, pack my knapsack with some meal, some salt. Get my rifle and some more cartridges.
Son, I'll not be a party to this escape of yours.
You'll do what I tell you, or else.
Don't point that gun at your father.
Better do what he says, Mr. Durand. He's gone plumb loco.
Never mind the reason. Get it done, Dad.
All right, Early.
Oh, my poor little boy. What have they done?
Quiet. Heard a car. Look out that window and see who it is.
Why, it's Chuck Lewis and another man.
Chief of Police Lewis, eh?
There's Dave with him.
One of your brother deputies, eh, Riley?
I told you they'd come here.
Well, come out if you're in there.
Mr. Davis is coming in.
Oh, no, he's not. Open that door, Riley.
What are you going to do?
I said open that door and stand in it. Don't come any closer, Baker. You either, Lewis.
Why, you killed them both.
Come back here, Riley. Stop, Riley.
Earl, please don't shoot anymore.
Look at him go. He's running through that timber like a scared rabbit.
What happened? I heard shooting.
I just shot a couple of more skunks out in the yard, Dad. Better haul them off.
Deputy Baker had died immediately before the bullet for the crazed boy. Durand's grief-stricken parents rushed Chief Lewis to a hospital in Powell. But the wounded man died without regaining consciousness. And Earl Durand fled to the hills. 2 hours later, he approached the home of a rancher.
Well, howdy, Durand. Heard you was in jail.
I was. I broke out.
Oh, you broke out, huh? Well, don't be hanging around here. I don't want no officers coming around my place.
Just stop talking and give me what guns and ammunition you got around here.
No, sir. I'm not giving no escape jailbird nothing. Now clear out before
you
I...
heard me. Give me the guns you've got around here and be quick about it.
Now, wait a minute. Don't go getting hot under the collar, young fella. Sure. You can have all the guns I've got. Just got a couple of rifles and a box or two of cartridges.
They'll do for a while. Sell them out here.
Sure. Sure. Here you are, Earl. Drop around again sometime when you can't stay so long.
Goodbye, Andy. See if you can't stop your teeth from chattering. Drop around to Clark's Fort Canyon sometime and see me. I'm living on old bear tooth now.
The rancher spread the alarm that Durand had been at his home. A dragnet was spread between the house and the hills. Meantime, posses organized by Stephen were moving in toward the mountains. From Yellowstone County in Montana came under Sheriff O'Donnell and a posse of deputies to assist the Wyoming officers. From Carbon County, Montana, Sheriff McPhase brought a group of men to join the hunt for the youthful killer. Meantime, Sheriff Blackburn of Park County had taken over command of the posse. Next morning, March 22nd at 4 o'clock, Art Thornburg was awakened by persistent knocking at his door.
All right. Keep your shirt on. I'm coming.
Hello, Thornburg.
Yeah, Earl. What'd you doing out this time of night?
I've got to get up to Clark's Fort Canyon.
What's that got to do with me? What's you getting me up for?
You're going to drive me up.
Oh, no, I'm not.
Listen, Thornburg. I shot two men today, and I'm not in any mood to argue with you. I want what guns you've got here and the ammunition you've got for them. You're going to drive me up to the Little Rocky.
Mm.
I'll make it the rest of the way on foot.
But I can't leave my wife here.
You don't have to. Wake her up.
And take her out into this weather?
Are you going to get started, or do I have to get rough?
All right, sure. Just put your rifle down. We'll get started right away.
This will be okay. Right here, Art.
Sure. This is as far as we can take you.
This is all right. I'll make it on foot from here on.
Anything else we can do for you?
Can't think of a thing.
Well, so long, Earl.
Go on back to Powell and tell Blackburn where you left me. Maybe he'll have nerve enough to come after me.
Speeding back to Powell, Thornburg reported the abduction to Sheriff Blackburn. Obtaining bloodhounds from the prison at Canyon City, Colorado, Sheriff Blackburn and his party again took up the trail of Earl Duran.
Looks like the hounds are having a hard time sticking to the trail.
I'm afraid they're not going to be much good, Sheriff. Duran's wearing overshoes. Chemicals in the rubber killed the human sense the hounds need for trailing.
Yes, I was afraid of that when I sent for them, but at least it was a chance.
Well, might as well call them in. Start telling them Indian fashion.
I guess so.
Hey, Ben! Take the dogs back to camp. We can't use them.
Looks like the trail leads straight up here a ways, and then it disappears.
Maybe Tarzan took to the trees.
That's a good newspaper yarn, that Tarzan has a Teton stuff. But I know the boy pretty well. He's just a mixed-up fellow who doesn't know what it's all about.
Personally, I think he's crazy.
Probably went off his base when he realized he was going to be penned up for a while in jail.
Yeah, I've seen him do that lots of times. In the big house, they call it stir-crazy.
I think you'll find it's different with Duran. He loved the outdoors too much to think he'd spend a part of his life in jail.
Yeah, I'm afraid he'll spend a lot of it in jail if we catch up with him now.
Well, I don't think we'll ever take him alive.
Neither do I, for that matter.
Oh, here's the trail again. Looks pretty fresh.
Yeah, he couldn't have gone very far in the 3 or 4 hours since he got out of Thornburg's car.
Hey, wait a minute. There's a clearing ahead. The trail seems to skirt that clearing a little to the right. That's a swell place for an ambush.
All right, men. Durant may be hiding just beyond that clearing there.
And there's a good place to hide just behind those rocks on the other side.
Joe, take it a dozen or so of the men and spread out on the right side of those rocks to keep out of sight.
All right, Sheriff. You and Tom...
King, you take a bunch and cover the left of the clearing. Benyon, you and I can keep the rest here.
Sure.
Keep quiet, and if you see Durant, use your own judgment.
You think he's up there, Sheriff?
I've got a hunch he is. Hey, Linneberry, where do you think you're going?
Heck, I'm not going to stand around in the snow all day. I'm going out there and get that bird that's behind those rocks.
Come back here, you fool. If he's there, he'll shoot you so full of lead, we won't be able to turn you over.
Don't worry about Linneberry, Sheriff. He'll take care of himself.
He's a friend of yours, isn't he, Argento?
Sure. We're like brothers. Well, you better persuade him to stay here.
No, don't worry. He'll be all right.
What was that?
Sounded like a rifle shot.
Linneberry's down. I saw him fall. The man's up there all right.
That makes three men he's killed.
Four shots. Three men.
Hey, come back here, Argento. Do you want to get killed, too?
They killed my friend. I'll kill him with my own bare hands. I'll kill him with mine. No. Five shots. Four men.
Argento fell right across Linneberry's body.
He's got to get the Rand out of there.
All right, men. He's behind those big rocks. Start blasting.
The portable radio receivers carried by the posse were in process of being moved up the mountainside. Moore realized that the message would have to be delivered by runner. With two companions, he drove toward the advance camp. Nearing the scene, he was stopped by a man dressed as a deputy sheriff.
Hey, how about a ride up to the camp?
Sure, hop in.
Nice car you've got here. New one, eh?
Yep.
But it looks better going the other way.
Yeah? Well, I got a message for the sheriff.
What's in it?
I don't know. Sealed telegram.
You better turn around and take me back to town.
You nuts. Thought you were supposed to be chasing Duran.
I am Duran.
You'll never catch him. What did you say?
I said I am Duran. Turn around.
Yes, sir.
Drive me back to Deaver. I've got to pick up some rifle cartridges at the express office. Well, this is as far as you birds go. Stop the car and get out. You got this new car insured?
Sure.
Well, you wouldn't want to lose any money on it. Don't tell them what it'll look like when you see it again.
Don't let that worry you.
You mind if I tear these wind wings off? I may have to do some shooting, and I wouldn't want this glass to break my face. So long, Moore.
Leaving Moore and his companions stranded near an abandoned mine, Duran drove directly to his hometown, Powell, and to the First National Bank.
Morning, Mr. Nelson.
Good morning, Les. Why, Earl Duran, what are you doing
this
here?
This is a stick-up, Mr. Nelson. Just tell everybody to do what I say and nobody will get hurt.
Well, you can't get away with this, Duran.
That's what they've been telling me. Don't worry about me.
Oh, what do you expect to get out of this?
Whatever money you've got here. Line up against the wall. All of you, and don't do any talking.
Be careful with those guns, Duran.
Okay, Nelson. Open the vault and let's get going.
We can't. The time lock's on them. The vault won't open.
You're lying, Nelson, but I don't care. I won't get out of here alive anyway.
I'm glad you realize that.
I'll just take what you've got here in the cage and tie you and the other two boys together with these bootlaces and use you to help me get away.
Well, there's a couple of thousand there. That ought to do you a while.
Sure. Hey, Gopher. You and Newton, come over here.
All right.
Stand back to back with Nelson here. That's it. Mm-hmm. We'll just tie you together like this. And walk you to the front door with me. Ahead of me. Oh. Rest of you people, stay where you are.
Don't you realize that if anyone sees you in here, we might get killed, too?
That's a chance you'll have to take. But by the way, I think I'll shoot up the place a little, just for excitement.
You crazy fool. You'll have every man in town in your neck.
So what? Go on, move.
Hey, they're coming
out. Wait a minute. Let me take a look out that door. Oh. So that bird in the drugstore is going to stick his head out, is he?
That'll discourage. Look out! Oh, for God's sake, Duran. You shot Johnny.
No, I didn't. Some bird across the street did it. I'll get him.
Oh. Nelson, come on. They got Duran. He fell back into the lobby.
Well, I'll be. He saved his last shot for himself. And he was the guy that couldn't miss.
In just a moment, we shall hear the concluding facts regarding our program. Meanwhile, just a suggestion, friends. With the hills and valleys carpeted with lavish displays of wildflowers, many of you will be seeking out your favorite beauty spots. Whether your quest takes you near or far, ensure the full enjoyment of your journey by taking with you the protection of Rialuf and the smooth, abundant, and money-saving power of Rio Grande Crack, the gasoline of police car performance. And now, Captain Jones.
Earl Duran saved his last shot for himself. He made good his boast of never be taken alive. As sad as his story may be, Durant's act proved once more the truth of the statement. Crime cannot pay.
Thank you, Captain Joe.
Park County, Wyoming Sheriff's Office calling all cars, attention all cars, cancellation broadcast 278 regarding an escaped prisoner. Suspect in this case committed suicide. That's all. Rolls and quits.
This is your narrator, Fred Strickland, bidding you good night for Rio Grande. Next week at this time, Rio Grande will present the case of the rope-bound trunk. This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.